Hello, I'm Hisashi Murakami from University of Tokyo. Here, I'll talk about our study on collective human behavior, especially crowd behavior. Collective animal groups often seem to behave as if having one body and or one mind as a whole. This usually means that a global ordered state emerges from inter-individual interactions without external controls. Such a collective mind metaphor is usually considered on bird flocking, fish schooling, and swarming of other animals. In addition to them, human crowds also show various collective patterns. We consider that there is an advantage to consider the metaphor through the human crowds. Namely, we can intervene in individual interactions easier than other animal groups in a way. Here, we show results from intervention experiments on human crowds. Actually, human crowds provide paradigmatic examples of self-organizations. They sometimes result in serious disasters. For example, if a huge number of people gathers in one place, they suddenly transition to turbulent flows or stop-and-go waves. These panic stampedes can trigger the deadly trampling of people. On the other hand, they can also offer functional benefits to the world groups, which increase global traffic efficiency. Among efficient self-organizations in human crowds, the lane formation is the most vivid example. Lane formation occurs in a crowded street, like in the famous Shibuya crossing. Flows of moving pedestrians in opposite directions spontaneously separate into several lanes with uniform walking directions. This separation reduces avoidance behavior among the pedestrians and enhances the efficiency of overall traffic flow. This patterning occurs in the absence of an external or central control, such as a leader or conductor. And pedestrians do not intend to seek out the global patterns. In other words, the functional organization emerges from the local interactions among individuals, so it's often called the wisdom of crowds. To understand the underlying mechanism of crowds, researchers have proposed various models. Most previous models describe pedestrian dynamics as an interaction potential or a social force. This is very similar to the repulsive potential among physical particles. Although this can reproduce a lot of crowd behavior, recent experiments reveal that the physics-inspired models do not completely explain the empirical observations. For example, according to recent experiments, individual interaction is fundamentally anticipatory in nature. In other words, pedestrians' motions are influenced not only by the current positions of their neighbors, but also by their anticipated future positions. So, researchers suggest that pedestrians are not passively repelled by their neighbors, but actively seek a clear passage through the crowd. Then, if so, one would consider that trajectories of pedestrians should dynamically evolve in time and show searching patterns deviating from the direct path to their destination. Indeed, we previously showed that pedestrians' anticipatory path-seeking behavior can be described as leavy walk, which is known as an optimal strategy in animal foraging. These anticipatory path-seeking ability of pedestrians should be related to emergent organizational patterns. Then question arises, is there any relation between individual anticipation and self-organization? In this study, we tested the hypothesis that individual anticipation can facilitate global patterning in human crowds. To this end, we employed mobile phone distraction, which has been considered to make pedestrians fixated 75% on the phone and significantly reduces pedestrian visual field. So this should make pedestrians difficult to mutually anticipate their motions. Then we consider that if the distraction causes a deterioration of global patterning, the self-organization facilitated by anticipation may be inferred. Now, let's move on to the experimental setup. First, we employed 54 male students as participants and divided them into two groups to make balanced bidirectional flow. And we constructed a straight mock corridor, mainly composed of the measurement area and two waiting areas. Each waiting area has 9 starting lines with an equal distance. As instructions, we asked the participants to walk in their usual way. Also, we informed that there could be people who would walk while using a mobile phone. We did this to decrease the risk of direct collision induced by the distraction and to avoid a sort of progressive learning. During experiments, we recorded pedestrian behavior from above and tracked their trajectories frame by frame. Moreover, to visually distract the pedestrians and disrupt potential anticipatory interactions, we imposed an additional task on 3 participants in one of the two groups. We asked these 3 participants to solve as many one-digit additions as possible. We hypothesized that distracted pedestrians located in front of the group would have the most influence on the overall crowd dynamics. To test this, we set 3 experimental conditions, front, middle, and rear, in addition to a baseline condition in which nobody was distracted. In the front condition, 3 participants in either group were randomly selected to perform the additional task while walking and assigned to the frontmost 3 positions. The mid and rear conditions were the same as the front condition, except that the distracted pedestrians were assigned to the middle or rear positions respectively. The experiments were replicated 12 times under each condition. Now let's move on to the results section. These are sample videos of each condition. Pedestrians in each group initially walk in opposite directions, deviating from the flow direction. Later, they self-organize into unidirectional lanes, following straight lines. The distracted pedestrians in the front condition seemed to disturb the overall behavior more than they did in the other conditions. To account for these observations quantitatively, we first calculated each pedestrian's walking speed in the measurement area. We observed that pedestrians only in the front condition were significantly slower than those in the baseline condition. This suggests that distracted pedestrians only in the front condition influenced the overall flow, as we expected. Next, to investigate the self-organization process of lane formation, we calculated the order parameter, which is widely used for measuring the stratification degree of bidirectional flow. Its value ranges 0 and 1. The larger the value, the clearer the lane formation. Left figures show plots of the order parameters as a function of time. Under the baseline condition, the plot looks roughly like a trapezoid, composed of a steady increase in the order parameter, which suggests progressive development of lanes, and a plateau during a certain period of time, which suggests maintenance of formed lanes, and a steady decrease, which suggests a gradual collapse of lanes. This trend was also observed in the rear condition and less clearly in the middle condition, but it was not observed in the front condition. Under the front condition in particular, we observed that lanes developed more slowly than under the other conditions. To verify this, we investigated the onset of lane formation by calculating the time at which the order parameter exceeded 0.8 for the first time. We found that the onset of lane formation in the front condition was significantly later than in the baseline condition, but not in the others. This suggests that only the distracted pedestrians in the front condition disturb the facilitation of self-organization. The following question thus arises: How is individual behavior, such as local collision avoidance behavior and path-seeking behavior in particular, influenced by the distraction? And how is the effect related to global patterning? To answer this, we focused on the baseline and front conditions and pedestrians' behaviors until the onset of lane formation, where path-seeking behavior most likely happens. Also, here and hereafter, we analyzed pedestrians' behaviors in more detail through a stratified analysis, where we divided the front condition data into three subgroups, as seen in this illustration, namely distracted, same-directed, and opposite-directed. Distracted represents distracted pedestrians. Same-directed represents pedestrians walking in the same direction as the distracted ones. Opposite-directed represents pedestrians walking in the opposite direction as the distracted ones. We assumed that the distraction would increase the risk of local collision among pedestrians, and that pedestrians would need to perform sudden large turns or steps to avoid a collision. We here show the temporal features of pedestrians' turns. If pedestrians performed collision avoidances locally and suddenly, they would slow down to avoid a collision, make turns with a relatively large turn angle, and then increase their speed to catch up with the preceding pedestrians. As for indicators to investigate this, we determined angular deviations of the velocity vector from the desired direction, that is x-axis here, at time t. Also, we determined changes in an individual's walking speed by calculating differences between speeds at time t and time t minus dt, where dt was a time period and dt equal 1 second. Figures show the two-dimensional frequency distribution of the indicators. The distribution in the baseline condition has a narrower range with smaller changes in speed and deviation than the others. This suggests that pedestrians under the baseline condition did not perform sudden turns, probably because of anticipation. On the other hand, distributions of other subgroups ranges widely. This suggests that pedestrians take large sudden steps. Moreover, if we calculated the absolute value of the product of the two indicators and considered it as an index of a sudden turn, the index in the baseline condition was significantly smaller than the others. Hence, this again suggests that pedestrians normally avoid collisions in advance by anticipation. Next, we considered how the distraction influences pedestrians' path-seeking behavior. We previously showed that when pedestrians anticipate their neighbors' motions to seek their ways through the crowd, this path-seeking behavior shows leave walk process with parallel step length distribution. Here, we also tested whether pedestrians' movements followed the leave walk process and investigated the effect of the distraction on this path-seeking behavior. To this end, we decomposed the individual trajectories into an X component, that is along the corridor length, and a Y component, that is perpendicular to the corridor length. Then, we focused on the latter, which is considered to be the most related to searching activities of pedestrians. Here, step lengths were calculated as the Y components of the distances between directional changes as seen in the figure. These figures show the step length distributions for each trial. We found that for the distracted pedestrians, the statistical results show that the proportion of trials showing parallel step length distributions was the lowest of all groups. These results suggest that distracted pedestrians sometimes failed to perform their usual walking, while others remained path-seeking behavior. Finally, we investigated the relationship between global patterning and local individual movements. As indexes, we focused on maximum step length for individual path-seeking. This represents the order of magnitude of the step length distribution and implies the level of local collision risk that pedestrians were forced to avoid. And for global patterning, we employed the onset of lane formation again. Interestingly, we observed that the onset of lane formation was positively affected by the maximum step length of opposite-directed members as well as same-directed ones. Contrary, there were no significant effects on baseline and distracted pedestrians. This suggests a possibility that the delayed global patterning was caused by the decision-making of non-distracted pedestrians, especially opposite-directed members, rather than by that of the distracted pedestrians. Finally, we will move on to the discussion. First, we observed that distracted pedestrians intensely performed local collision avoidance and sometimes failed to achieve the usual walking strategy. This is consistent with our assumption that pedestrians performing path-seeking behavior can avoid collisions in advance. On the other hand, somewhat surprisingly, opposite-directed pedestrians also performed local collision avoidance, even if they were able to dedicate their visual resources to their walking task, and actually showed path-seeking behavior. We speculate that this was caused by the uncertainty of the motions of distracted walkers. This is because the opposite-directed pedestrians most likely obtained less information from the gaze direction of the distracted pedestrians, from which humans usually infer other people's movements. Moreover, according to a recent behavioral neuroscience study, decision during action is essential for human decision-making because the decision may involve deadlines and time constraints for action. Therefore, if the uncertainty of motion is introduced in the form of oncoming distracted people, pedestrians will have to continue to seek real information. And then they will sometimes reach the situation where a collision is imminent and turn immediately before colliding with the distracted walkers. So we conclude that mutual anticipation contributes more to a smooth walk than one-way anticipation. In addition, we observe the link between individual anticipation and the self-organization process in a crowd. Namely, onset of lane formation was statistically predicted by the maximum step length in opposite-directed walkers. Therefore, this suggests that if the non-distracted pedestrians can successfully anticipate motions of the distracted people and walk smoothly, corrective patterning is achieved rapidly. Otherwise, patterning is delayed. Moreover, considering all results together, because non-distracted pedestrians maintained anticipatory path-seeking behavior resulted in heavy walk, such a process might guarantee emergent patterning in human crowds. Finally, we would like to note that anticipatory behavior also contributes to cooperative human decision-making through synchronization between two persons. And interestingly, mutual anticipation is also considered to be crucial to perform robust collective behavior in animal groups, which results in heavy walk as well. Then, we would like to suggest that mutual anticipation can be an underlying mechanism in various self-organizing systems and a key factor to develop the collective mind analogy. That's it. Thank you very much.
Hello. My name is Javier Galadi, PhD from the University of Seville, Spain. In this research line, we are applying the model dynamical system theory to consciousness. So we have faces, consciousness, or subjective experience from dynamical system theory in two different ways. Toward the integrated information theory, IIT, one of the most prestigious theories on consciousness, and toward the global dynamics of the human brain. Both lines with specific methods. In this paper, in PLOS Computational Biology, we developed a continuous version of the integrated information theory. Tononi's IIT is formulated for binary discrete dynamical systems. So in this work, we map IIT formalisms to continuous dynamical systems. Our three greatest achievements in this work were the theoretical conceptualization and the computation of information and integration in continuous dynamical system and the dependence of the integrated information on the topology of the system. But today, this talk is about dynamical system applied to global brain dynamics. Specifically, we want to characterize the attractor landscape for different brain states. The energy or attractor landscape of the human brain is extremely complex and changes over time. Its characterization is a central unsolved problem in neuroscience. We have used empirical data provided by our collaborators. Most of them are ball signal, fMRI data of brain activity. This talk is specifically about Coma data. The attractor landscape or energy landscape characterize all these steady states and limit the possible future behavior of the system. The attractor landscape transforms the behavior of an empirical complex system into a landscape of states. We will characterize the attractor landscape through the so-called energy levels. For this, we need to introduce the concept of global attractor. We define the global attractor as a compact, invariant, and attracting subset of the phase space. The structure of the global attractor can be given in terms of isolated invariant subsets and the trajectories connecting them. These isolated invariant subsets are typically stationary points, but could be also periodic orbits or chaotic dynamic. The global attractor here in yellow color comprises only bounded solutions. Outside global attractor, solutions are unbounded. If the dynamical system supports a Lyapunov function, association of energy levels can be defined. The Lyapunov function is always decreasing along the arrows. The highest energy level is comprised of invariant subsets that receive no solution, in other words, unstable sets. Then each lower level is defined, including isolated invariant subsets that receive solution only from the previously defined higher levels. So the red circle belongs to the third level, not to the second, because it receives a solution from the second level. We will use the number of energy levels, NOEL, to characterize the energy landscape or attractor landscape. We will check that the greatest variability and the lowest average of the NOEL empirical distribution are a biomarker of the wealth, abundance of subjective experience, consciousness. The greater variability of the NOEL can be called a structural metastability, since it possesses the tendency of the systems to change local attractor. Concept from dynamical system theory can be illustrated by the locable terror system, where alpha are the growth rate and gamma, the structural connectivity. In lockable terror systems, the isolated invariant structures are always stationary points. In this case, the structural network in which the lockable terror is defined is comprised of two nodes. And these are the solutions of this example. The global attractor is the set of all bounded solutions in yellow area, and there are four, one, two, three, four stationary points. The structure of the global attractor is a new network made by four nodes associated with the four stationary points and directed links associated to connecting solutions. Non-null components of the associated stationary point are shown in black and null in gray. In this example, there are three energy levels. The trivial solution, the saddle points, and the stable solution. Here, a lockable terra with four nodes, where alpha are now functions of time. Changes in the alpha produce changes in the attractor landscape. So the number of energy levels also change over time. In lockable terra systems, the only stable point is a single stationary point always in the lowest level, where the stability is maximum. This stable point is called globally asymptotically stable solution, GAS. The GAS is the point toward the system is attracted. Since any initial point from each side, it may be not in the border, but from inside of the phase space, will converge to the GAS. Traditional analysis focus on local properties of a given steady state, but it doesn't explain transitions between attractors. Additionally, global brain dynamics don't converge or stabilize around a fixed set of invariants and should be described as a continuous flow of quipped and irregular oscillation. So we propose to characterize the transition between attractor by means of a non-stationary or dynamic attractor landscape. To do this, we fit the parameters of the model in each short time interval. This method, called model transform, allows simple theoretical models to be applied to complex empirical systems. The model transform can be seen as a generalization of trivial concepts such as the curvature. The circumference is the simplest model that allows us to know the curvature parameter. And the helix is the simplest model to measure the torsion value. Each model answers a different question. So we have to find the simplest model that allows us to answer the question towards which state is attracted to the brain and one time point, and which is the attractor landscape at one time point. Lockable terra equations are ideal for answering this question because they support a Lyapunov function so that its invariant can be ordered in energy levels, and we have got an algorithm of low computational complexity for calculating the gas and the null. Lockable terra include empirical information about the structural connectivity of the brain, the conditions for the existence and uniqueness of the global attractor are well known here, and local alter equations are relatively simple, but could include complex enough attractor landscape with billions of billions stationary points. Locke-Volterra transform is the model transform when the Locke-Volterra model is used. So we reach a time-varying attractor landscape by means of time-varying alphas or growth rates of Locke-Volterra equation. Solving for alpha, we obtain this, where U and its derivative will be empirical values from ball signal obtained using fMRI. This Locke-Volterra transform defines a Locke-Volterra system that fits exactly the empirical data. Let us remark that we are now assessing the Locke-Volterra equation as a brain activity model, but as a tool to obtain the temporal evolution of the global attractor. This flowchart summarizes our method, but ultimately we transform the time series of empirical data into time series of attractor landscape. In order to assess how different the distribution of the NOEL for different brain states are, we calculate a statistical hypothesis text, the Wilkinson text. This process is now applied to Coma data in three groups where controls are healthy subjects, and it is assumed that the subjective experience of the unresponsive group is extremely poor, while that of the minimal group is somewhat higher, although far below the healthy subjects. Here we calculate the average NOEL for each subject, and then all these averages become part of a distribution in each group. Similarly, these are the distribution across subjects of each group of the null standard deviation across time, and the result for both means and standard deviation are compatible with all thesis that higher level of consciousness correspond to greater structural metastability and lower average null. At 7 subnetwork parcellation of the brain was used, this allows us to verify the existence of each individual point fully, its individual stationary point. Thanks to this, we can measure the leafiness of the structure of the global attractor called frondosity. Frondosity is really a measure of the absence of integration. So the integration is higher in the control group and reach its lowest values in the unresponsive group. The variability of the frondosity across time can be seen as a measure of complexity, so that the greater complexity will correspond again to the control group and the lower to the unresponsive group. We name criticality to the proximity of a transition between two different structures of the global attractor. The highest level of criticality occurs in the group, control group, while again, the lowest values are in the unresponsive group. In cooperative Locke-Volterra systems, we can focus on the stationary points, which contained some new operation of a certain active area, active network, and call them cooperative points. In this energy level, of this sample, there are two. This, which correspond to the activation of area 3 because of the cooperation of 6 and 7, respectively. The cooperation value is defined as the sum for all cooperative points of its level minus 1. We can also look at the highest energy level of a cooperative point. In both cases, the highest cooperation occurs in the control group, while again the lowest values are in the unresponsive group. Let's remark that the model transform allows simple models to be applied to complex empirical systems. Each different model answers new questions and opens different possibilities in practical and theoretical application. For instance, a Kuramoto transform in which the natural or intrinsic frequency were the parameters to be fitted will provide a non-stationary landscape with stable periodic orbits, alternatively to the stationary points of the local Terra transform. And finally, by way of summary, let's say that the study of the structure of the non-stationary energy landscape allows us to establish that at higher levels of consciousness, we find greater variability in the number of energy levels, less leafiness of the structures, greater variability of the leafiness, greater criticality, and greater cooperation. Before the end, I would like to thank my collaborators and supervisors. Thank you for your attention, and I invite your inquiries and comments.
Hello, my name is Alexander Egoyan. I am associate professor at the Department of Biomechanics and Computer Technologies at the Georgian State University of Physical Education and Sport. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers of this excellent conference for giving me an opportunity to present my work. The title of my presentation is Two Complementary Models of Human Perception, Two-Dimensional Holographic and Three-Dimensional Realistic and the Relationship Between Them. Perception cannot be explained using the traditional natural science approach alone, because natural science explains physical processes in the brain only from the point of view of the external observer. It cannot provide a reliable explanation for our senses, perceptions, and feelings. The main idea of this work is that idealistic and materialistic views of reality are complementary, and there should be two complementary theories. The first one, describing the world from the idealistic point of view, and the second one from the materialistic point of view. A new holistic theory explaining our perception has been proposed recently by me and is based on the concept of elastic membrane. Elastic membranes are material multidimensional objects which have two metrics, internal and external. During elastic deformations, only the external metric changes, while the internal metric stays the same. The example of a three-dimensional elastic membrane may be our universe, which may be embedded or not embedded into a higher dimensional space. For simplicity, in this work, we treat our universe as a flat, infinite three-dimensional elastic membrane, filling all the space. Such a membrane doesn't need to be embedded into a higher dimensional space. The reality may be considered as a process of time evolution of macroscopic material objects, elastic membranes. An embedded membrane in this multidimensional vault will look differently for external and internal observers. From the outside, it will look like a material object with smooth infinitesimal geometry, while from the inside, it will look like a space-time described in general relativity. Gravity in this model is explained as transformation of material properties of the surface of the membrane. The density of the membrane will decrease under the effect of internal gravity. The internal gravity does not change the external metric of the membrane. This model requires a preferred space-like foliation of space-time. This slide shows how a one-dimensional elastic membrane changes after stretching and squeezing. We should distinguish two types of stretching. The first one changes the form of the membrane, while the second one is caused by squeezing and does not change the form of the membrane. This slide shows how a fragment of a two-dimensional elastic membrane changes after stretching and local squeezing. A two-dimensional elastic membrane with closed topology may be embedded into the elastic membrane of our universe. According to the theorem, these two-dimensional elastic membranes with closed topology are associated with ourselves and are responsible for our perceptions. Two-dimensional elastic membranes arise from such properties of qualia as, first, indivisibility. Qualia cannot be separated into pieces. Continuity, qualia are continuous. Permanent character, the character of perception does not change during the process of perception. Two-dimensionality, we cannot perceive two different signals in the same direction. And macroscopic size, qualia are also microscopic. Each elastic membrane is indivisible wholeness. It cannot be torn or pierced, but it can be stretched, squeezed, or curved. Our perception may be considered as the result of elastic oscillations of two-dimensional elastic membrane with closed topology embedded in our brains. Only one elastic membrane responsible for perception will be embedded into the brain of the selected organism. We suppose that initially, elastic membrane resides in the thalamus. In the thalamus, it is squeezed around thalamic nuclei. From there, signals are projected to the cerebral cortex. Membranes stretch along the paths of signals propagation, the stretched regions of the membrane will not produce perceptions because their interactions with brain neurons are very weak. Perceptions will arise in the cerebral cortex, where squeezed regions of the membrane will occupy energetically favorable positions around brain microtubules. This slide shows how the elastic membrane propagates from one neuron to another. The membrane is shown by red. We can see stretched regions and the squeezed region where perception happens. The underlying elastic membrane unifies perceptions produced in the cerebral cortex. The observer does not perceive macroscopic weak stretches and will see only the unified picture. For example, the feeling of the red color will be produced by the vibrations in the tips of the branch structure of the membrane. But the observer will not perceive these stretched regions and will see only the unified picture. For him, the whole region of the membrane will be colored by red. Gravitational modulation. It is supposed that particles in the human brain neurons produce gravitation collectively in the form of gravitational waves with modulated amplitudes and frequencies. The masses of the particles will change periodically within a very short period of time. But the average values of masses during the period of modulation will stay the same. Gravitational modulation will try to optimize space-time geometry and increase the stability of the system. Gravitational modulation can have a significant effect on the brain processes. In spite of the weakness of gravitation itself, the periodical change of the masses of elementary particles caused by gravitational modulation will affect electromagnetic interactions between the particles, depending on the strength of modulation. This picture shows how masses of three particles having different parameters of gravitational modulation compensate each other. Complex periodical structures are supposed to be more suitable for gravitation and the gravitational modulation. Brain microtubules, due to their periodical structure, are considered as possible gravitational modulators. The sources of gravitational modulation, they can create gravitational modulation and spread it to other particles and atoms. For example, alpha tubulins and beta tubulins can participate in gravitational modulation with different phase shifts. This will sustain and preserve stability in the system. Elastic membranes try to occupy energetically favorable positions around brain microtubules with large enough amplitudes of gravitational modulation. The parameters of gravitational modulation may change from time to time and to achieve more stability in the system. Gravitational modulation will try to preserve quantum coherence in the brain microtubules and support quantum computations. The elastic quasi-membrane theory. The second theory of perception is three-dimensional and uses two-dimensional elastic quasi-membranes to explain the holistic physical processes in the brain. Elastic quasi-membranes are not real objects, but they have the geometry similar to that of real elastic membranes. This approach is very similar to the approach used in the solid-state physics, where phonons, magnons, and excitons proved to be very successful to explain the physics of solids. This theory also explains the interactions between two regions of the brain separated by a quasi-membrane using quasi-membrane and quasi-particles. But in this case, the interactions will be mediated by platonic values embedded in space-time geometry. the squeezed regions of the quasi-membrane will correspond to the most active and stable regions of brain neurons involved in perception. Microtubules are considered as possible gravitational modulators. The parameters of gravitational modulation of microtubules will change simultaneously. This means that microtubules will be connected not only through the wave function of the system, but through the gravitational field as well. This, according to the theory, the collapse of the wave function of the system will be followed by the gravitational remodulation and vice versa. Gravitational modulation tries to stabilize space-time geometry and decrease the entropy of the system. Gravitational modulation is a feature of or quality which distinguishes living organisms from non-living matter. Living organisms can spread gravitational modulation to other living or non-living objects, achieving better coherence and harmony with them. This may happen during their synchronous motion by touching or having contact. Such coherence and harmony are very important in sport, dance, and other activities. This table shows pairs of opposite notions across two theories, such as idealistic, materialistic, multidimensional, three-dimensional, elastic, rigid, deterministic, non-deterministic, holistic, reductionist, intuitive, irrational, phenomenological, experimental. We call the first theory holographic because its basis of perception is a two-dimensional elastic membrane. And we call the second theory realistic because its basis of perception is the three-dimensional complex system of elementary particles, the particles of our organisms. Two theories are complementary. Methods and ideas of the holistic theory have their interpretation in the reductionist theory, and vice versa. For example, we can use geometrical models of the holistic theory in the reductionist theory, and vice versa. With the better understanding of the brain structure, we can uncover new phenomenological models of brain processes. The elastic quasi-membrane theory does not require other dimensions, new physical objects, or a new geometry. It may be based on the existing physics and existing physical theories. Which theory of consciousness is the best candidate for the elastic quasi-membrane theory? Taking into account the gravitational character of the theory, its ability to preserve coherence, and the presence of periodical instant shifts of the system, we can conclude that the basic theory may be the Pedros-Hamerov or model of consciousness. In conclusion, I would like to say a few words about Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, who was a German writer and statesman, but he also did research in morphology, anatomy, and optics. Goethe himself saw his main contributions to culture as being in the area of science. Goethe proposed experimenters seek the natural, lawful organizing ideas or archetype behind specific natural phenomena. Goethe's science requires that we actively engage all our senses and trust that they can reveal the real world. For Goethe, knowledge is also about association, not only about separation. He insisted that scientists should be in a reciprocal participatory relationship with nature. This is a science of relationship, of wholeness and of quality. And with it, he hoped to understand nature globally, experiencing it as a kind of living organism of whose changing dynamics the observer was a part. Goethe's method of scientific experiment as mediator between experimenter and nature can be applied to studies of every kind, especially to the science of consciousness. Only since the 1970s, other mainstream scientists started to be interested in his scientific method. Among them were biologists Rupert Sheldrake and Brian Goodwin, and physicist Henry Bortoft, and others. The two models described in this work represent two well-known scientific methods. The first one proposed, the phenomenological approach proposed by Goethe, and the second one, the experimental method accepted in science. Two methods are complementary, and when properly combined, they will help us find a physical explanation to many consciousness phenomena. Thank you for watching.
Hello, I'm Yicong Lin. I am a neurologist from Department of Neurology, Xuanwu Hospital, Capital Medical University, Comprehensive Epilepsy Center of Beijing. My research interests are neuromodulation of neurological diseases. It is my great pleasure to share our work on the Science of Consciousness Conference 2020. The title of my presentation is the EEG and MRI-guided simultaneous transcranial direct current stimulation and repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation in a patient with minimally conscious state. There's nothing to disclose. A minimally conscious state is characterized by discernible behavioral evidence of consciousness that can't be reproduced consistently. A minimally conscious state may result from degenerative nervous system disorders or evolved from a coma or vegetative state. In MCS patients, integrated cortical functions are retained but not under-sustained. Minimally conscious state is a highly challenging clinical condition to treat. Notably, recent studies have demonstrated a potential therapeutic effect of non-invasive brain stimulation in patients with MCS. Repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation and transcranial direct current stimulation are two non-invasive brain stimulation techniques that have been developed in the past decades. High-frequency repetitive TMS can decrease GABAergic activity and decrease synaptic transmission through a long-term potentiation-like mechanism. A nodal TDCS can change the resting membrane potential by influencing ion channels and gradients, thus increasing cortical excitability. These techniques have recently been employed independently in the treatment of MCS and have shown some inspiring beneficial results. In this study, to maximize the benefit of non-invasive brain stimulation treatment in patients, we designed a simultaneous stimulation protocol in which the electrical stimulation and magnetic stimulation were delivered at the same time. We identified stimulation targets and evaluated the therapeutic effect by analyzing functional connections based on scalp EEG and fMRI. The left photo is the device and the right photo is the electrode cap. This is another study from our team, which showed us the synergistic effect of TDCS and repetitive TMS. The y-axis denotes the motor evoked potential modulation, which indicates the depression of cortical excitement. The red line is simultaneous TDCS and RTMS, the blue line is TDCS, and the purple line is TMS. Therefore, the application of cathodal TDCS with low-frequency repetitive TMS produces a stronger inhibitory effect compared to TDCS or repetitive TMS. This is our patient one, who was diagnosed with a minimally conscious state according to the coma recovery scale revised due to brainstem hemorrhage 1 month earlier. The patient spontaneously blinked his eyes infrequently. He could blink his eyes after pain stimulus, but could not consistently move to acoustic command. His eyes could move from the initial target to a new target for more than 2 seconds. There wasn't any vocalization or oral motor movement. The pupils were equal in size and reactive to light. Corneal reflexes and gag reflexes were bilaterally present. The Babinski sign was positive bilaterally. Before stimulation, the patient's CRSR score was 10 points, the Glasgow score was 10, the full outline of unresponsiveness score was 15, and the coma near coma scale score was 18. The EEG analysis was performed based on 1 hour 32 channel scope EEG data. Directional transfer function analysis was used. This figure showed us DTF spatial distribution in healthy controls and the patient. The color bar denotes the DTF values, and the first panel is the 8 healthy controls, and the second panel is the patient's result, which showed a significantly decreased DTF value in bilateral posterior regions when compared to the controls. And the third panel is the 15 electrodes with significantly reduced DTF values in patient when compared to those in controls. And the fourth panel is the average of DTF value of the 15 electrodes. The blue bar denotes the DTF value of the 15 electrodes in controls, and the red bar denotes those in patient. The upper panel is default mode network. So at the baseline, the patient showed decreased activity in the inferior parietal lobe, posterior cingulate cortex, and the mesiofrontal region. And the lower panel is the executive control network result. At the baseline, the patient showed decreased activity in the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex. Here we have our stimulation target. Based on the EEG and fMRI analysis results, we identified the target's location in the head model of the patient. The yellow circle denotes the anode electrode over P3 or P4. The green circle denotes the cathodal electrode over T3 or T4. The red lightning mark denotes the repetitive TMS site over P3 or P4. For the 20 minutes treatment on the right hemisphere, the anodal TDCS was delivered over P4 and the cathodal TDCS was delivered over T3. Meanwhile, 5 Hz repetitive TMS was delivered precisely over the anodal electrode at P4. Then, for the next 20-minute treatment on the left hemisphere, the anodal TDCS was delivered over P3 and the cathodal TDCS was delivered over T4. Meanwhile, 5 Hz repetitive TMS was delivered precisely over the anodal electrode at P3. The 14 sessions of simultaneous nodal TDCS and 5 Hz repetitive TMS were delivered over the course of 2 weeks, and a clinical evaluation was performed weekly. Direct current was delivered by a pair of saline-soaked silver cloth webbed sponge electrodes, and repetitive TMS was delivered through a circular coil. 40 minutes of stimulation, that is 20 minutes for each hemisphere, were given per day. The current was ramped up to 1.5 milliampere for the onset of stimulation, applied for 20 minutes, and ramped down to zero. When a TMS train consisted of 25 pulses delivered at 5 Hz with an inter-train interval of 55 seconds, in a single session, 500 pulses, that is 20 TMS trains, were delivered for 20 minutes. The strength of the stimulation was 70% of the resting motor threshold. This is spatial distribution of the DTF value in the patient before and after treatment. In first panel, the patient showed a significant increase in the DTF value in bilateral posterior regions after the stimulation. The second panel is the baseline. The third panel are the 12 electrodes with significantly higher DTF values after treatment compared to those before treatment. The red bar denotes the pre-treatment DTF value of the 12 electrodes in the patient, and the green bar denotes the post-treatment DTF values of the 12 electrodes in the patient. In the upper panel is default mode network. The first panel is baseline, and the third panel is healthy controls. The middle one showed an increase in intraparietal lobe and posterior cingulate cortex activity after the treatment. The lower is the executive control network. After treatment, as shown in the middle panel, the patient showed a decrease in dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex activity. The figure on the upper left showed the CRSR, Glasgow 4, and CNC scores throughout the course of the treatment. Compared to baseline, the CRSR and the CNC scores improved considerably, and the effect lasted for up to 1 month. The lower right figure showed the subscales of the CRSR score. The arousal and auditory functions, the green and dark blue lines, were the first to show improvement during stimulation. Then communication, which is light blue, improved. Finally, visual function and motor function, the orange and the gray lines, improved after the treatment. This is the patient 2, who was diagnosed with coma due to brainstem hemorrhage 1 week prior. The patient didn't respond well to stimulus except for some withdrawal in movement to pain stimulus and avoidance to light stimulus. The pupils were equal in size and slowly reactive to light. The corneal reflex was present on the left but diminished on the right. The dose head eye phenomenon was not present. The Babinski sign was positive on the right side. This patient was treated with medications and sham neurostimulation. At the baseline, the CRSR score was 3 points, the Glasgow score was 6, the FOR score was 5 points, and the CNC score was 22 points. This is the DTF spatial distribution. The first upper panel is 8 healthy controls, and the upper middle panel is patient 2, who showed a significantly decreased DTF value in bilateral posterior regions when compared to the healthy controls. The third upper panel shows the 8 electrodes with significantly reduced DTF values in patient 2 compared to those in controls. Up on the right upper panel is the average DTF value of the 8 electrodes, which which shows DTF was significantly lower in the patient 2 than in the controls. After sham stimulation, patient 2 showed a significant increase in the DTF value in bilateral posterior regions, as shown in the lower panels. These four electrodes are with significantly higher DTF values after treatment compared to those before treatment. This is the clinical scores in patient 2. Compared to the baseline, these scores didn't show much improvement after 2 weeks of sham stimulation. Here are some discussions. First, this is an exploratory study in which a minimally conscious state patient received simultaneous TDCS and repetitive TMS treatment based on brain network analysis of both EEG and fMRI. We utilized repetitive TMS with 5 Hz and 70% of the resting motor threshold and a nodal TDCS with 1.5 mA for safety and tolerability consideration. During stimulation, the MCS patient tolerated intervention well without displaying irritability, aggressiveness during head positioning, or TMS-TDCS delivery. Clinical assessment showed improvement in the patient. Another patient with similar structural damage was evaluated as a control and didn't show much clinical improvement. Moreover, brain network analysis based on EEG and fMRI played important roles in this study. First, these tools were used to identify stimulation targets, potentially leading to more precise modulation. In addition, post-treatment analysis of the brain network was used to evaluate the treatment effect. We speculate that brain network-guided simultaneous TDCS and repetitive TMS could be a promising treatment strategy for MCS. The stimulation target chosen in this study was the bilateral inferior parietal lobes based on combined functional and electrophysiological datasets. In patient 1, there was a significant decrease in the DTF value in the bilateral central parietal occipital regions. The inferior parietal lobe is involved in the default mode network, which is related to self-awareness and shows decreased brain activity during loss of consciousness. PET studies have shown that there is a correlation between default mode network integrity and the level of consciousness. The default mode network integrity decreased when descending from normal consciousness to minimally conscious state, vegetative state, and coma, as shown in this panel. Besides, the functional connections within the default mode network in MCS may reflect the chance of recovery. For example, different connectivity patterns could influence the efficacy of neurostimulation in MCS patients. The re-establishment of functional connections within default mode network regions may reflect the recovery of consciousness. In a literature review, previously reported targets are mostly in dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex rather than the inferior parietal lobe. As we know, the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex is involved in the functional executive control network, which is related to external awareness. In addition to the default mode network, the executive control network has also been demonstrated to be altered in disorders of consciousness and restored with the recovery of consciousness. In our study, we further analyzed the executive control network in patient 1 and found decreased activity in the bilateral dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex when compared with that in healthy controls. Therefore, we suspected that the patient may also benefit from stimulation over the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex. The default mode network and the executive control network are anti-correlated to each other in normal physiological conditions. However, these two networks are hypoactivated in patients in our study, potentially reflecting a reduction in the anticorrelation. The anticorrelated pattern has been shown to be of functional importance to the state of consciousness, but the dynamics of the anticorrelation between these two networks during the state of consciousness haven't been well clarified. This panel showed that the anticorrelation diminished or even disappears during conditions of altered consciousness. A stronger anticorrelation between these two networks have been shown to potentially reflect a better capacity to switch between internal and external modes of attention, which is necessary for maintaining conscious awareness. There are some limitations in this study. First, this is a preliminary two-case study. The patient with stimulation was in a minimally conscious state, and whether this treatment can be used in patients with other disorders of consciousness needs to be further explored. Additionally, patient 2 was not in precisely the same medical condition as patient 1. Patient 2 had coma and was enrolled in the study 1 week after stroke. All clinical scores showed a more severe condition than in patient 1. These factors likely contributed to the limited clinical improvement, so more homogeneous cases need to be studied in the future. Thank you very much for your attention. And this is my email. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Andrea de Paiva, and I'm here to present the paper Multisensory Experience Contributions to Unimodal Consciousness, the Importance of Architecture in the Discussion. I'd like to begin with a question. How do multisensory experiences of an environment and the atmosphere it creates contribute to our awareness of the environment itself and of the situations we live in it? Questions such as this have been driving psychologists and neuroscientists' research, especially over the last decades. But scientists are not the only ones who can benefit from it. Architects and designers, the ones who create the places where we live, work, socialize, study, and heal, can not only benefit from such discussions, but also collaborate to them. This paper aims to present a framework that brings architecture to the discussions scientists are having, suggesting a point of view in which we can observe how science and architecture can dialogue. To start our discussion, I propose that we look back at a notable event that happened in 2003. This was the year when ANFA, the Academy of Neuroscience for Architecture, was founded. It was idealized by Jonas Salk. His personal experience when he created the polio vaccine in the 50s made him realize that the environment with its multisensory atmosphere influences us in deeper levels than most of us imagine. At a time when Salk was stuck with his work, he spent a few weeks at an abbey at Assisi in Italy. It was then that he found the adequate mental state to create the vaccine that would save thousands of children in the years to come. The change in his mental state was attributed by him to the different environment which he found at the abbey. That, in turn, inspired him to support research regarding how the physical environment can affect our brain and behavior. Cases like that, together with all the research that has been emerging on perception and awareness, make us question how much we are impacted by the environment in which we find ourselves. According to the well-building standard, we spend more than 90% of our time in built environments. From cities to buildings, most of our lives are spent in places designed and built by men. However, through an evolutive perspective, the development in building technology and the resulting changes in our lifestyle are both very recent. It was only since the late 19th century when solutions such as steel structures, elevators, interior plumbing allowed architects to create skyscrapers. It was also only then when we were able to extend the day with electrical lighting, or when we got used to have control over the temperature of a building through central heating or air conditioning. Our understanding of distances also changed with cars, airplanes, the telephone, and more recently, the internet. The entire infrastructure of cities changed. and so did our lives and our relation with the many spaces we occupy. The stimuli we get from the physical environment was drastically transformed, especially over the last century. Cities became bigger and even more chaotic, with higher density and more traffic, resulting in air and noise pollution and more time spent to commute. They also became overwhelmed with visual information, from outdoors advertisement and bright lights even during nighttime, to the shapes of skyscrapers that do not match our human scale. On the other hand, on the inside, buildings became more and more minimalist, less colors, less textures, just a clean and aseptic environment. In parallel with this, several studies conducted in different countries throughout the last century have been pointing to a relation between the environment where individuals live, such as a city or a village, or where they grew up, and the higher risk of developing mental disorders. Could they be attenuated if we design different solutions? There are many studies pointing to how multisensory natural environments can change perception, conscious awareness, behavior, and well-being. Studies such as the ones conducted by Judith Heerwagen showed that animals from a zoo that were kept in minimalist environments started to present neurotic and antisocial behavior. But when they were back to multisensory experiences in natural environments, their behavior would go back to normal. Studies such as the ones conducted by Roger Ulrich showed that patients that stayed in rooms with windows showing natural views not only had a faster recovery after surgery, but also perceived less pain, requiring less medicine such as analgesics. Other studies, such as the ones conducted by Charles Spence and Steve Keller, showed that music and soundscapes could change doctors' performance in surgery, as well as patients' perception of pain and time. Finally, there are also studies showing how natural light in classroom, for instance, can enhance attention levels and learning, and how just by looking for a few minutes to an image of nature, such restorative pause, as psychologists Rachel and Stephen Kaplan called it, would help to increase focus and attention. So the question is, how can the multisensory atmospheres from the spaces designers create, and where we spend around 90% of our life, really affect perception, behavior, and well-being? How do our senses interact? And how do cross-modal stimuli interact and create what we perceive at the atmosphere of a place? Cross-modal perception involves interactions between two or more different sensory modalities. Studies in this field have been pointing to interesting directions. The McGurk effect is a classic example that illustrates how the brain combines multisensory information to create its own interpretation of what is happening outside our body.
Many of us have become quick to catch illusions that trick our eyes, but how often do you consider illusions of the ear? Are you really able to trust your ears and the things they hear? For example, listen to Greg speaking.
Bar, 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 bar.
What do you hear? If you heard bar, 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 you'd be right. But how about now?
Bar, 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 bar.
Chances are you heard far, far, far this time with an F, except you didn't. In fact, the audio didn't even change between the two videos.
Bar, bar, bar.
Strange as it may seem, what you hear depends on which video you're looking at. Go ahead, take turns watching each video and see how the sound morphs.
Bar, bar, bar.
This is a perfect example of something called the McGurk effect, which shows how our visuals can alter what we believe we're hearing.
The McGurk effect is remarkable in a way as to show how information from different senses interact. More than that, how congruent information from each sense can cooperate, while incongruent information can disturb perception. In the physical environment, when designers combine multisensory cues, it is possible to create stronger atmospheres. Take a look at this movie scene, for instance.
Thank you.
Although the visual properties of the movie are intact, the atmosphere of the scene changes according to the sound. If a thriller atmosphere in a movie can change into a fun atmosphere just by altering its soundscape, what can happen to the atmospheres of places if architects design with a multisensory experience in mind? How do soundscapes interact with light, smells, colors, shapes, and even tastes? Studies about what is called sonic seasoning have been showing that it is not only the visual image of a food and its chemical qualities that affect its taste. The sound of the environment can also impact on our taste perception, affecting both flavor and liking. Not only that, but the color of the environment where we consume food can also affect our perception of taste. There are many studies which show that the presentation of cues from multiple sensory modalities can have a profound impact on both behavior and perception. Multisensory stimuli have been shown to decrease simple reaction times and to facilitate stimulus detection, suggesting a convergence and integration of the signals in the brain, as defended by Barry Stein and Alex Meredith. Conversely, separating the same stimuli in space and or time can reduce neuronal responses and have detrimental effects on behavioral performance. In fact, behavioral enhancements were observed only upon the pairing of congruent cross-modal stimuli. But congruency of multisensory stimuli is not only about their physical qualities. Semantics also plays a key role in determining whether multisensory stimuli are congruent or incongruent. Recent studies have shown that in addition to their spatial, temporal, and physical qualities, multisensory stimuli must have a semantic match in order to generate behavioral benefits. This means that previous memories of past experiences and context can also influence perception. Responses were found to be faster in the presence of semantically congruent cross-modal cues, suggesting an integration of the contextual elements of multisensory stimuli. Bringing such findings to the architecture realm, how could semantically incongruent multisensory stimuli of buildings and cities affect our conscious experience and our well-being? One interesting example to be mentioned is the discussion about hospital atmospheres. How it is important to change the old-fashioned aseptic and cold atmosphere hospitals used to have to a more natural and cozier one. As mentioned before, studies have been showing the importance of nature in such environments to enhance well-being and recovery, lowering stress levels and perception of pain. Architects such as Stephen Keller and Elizabeth Calabrese, based on such findings, have created what they call biophilic design, which is basically a set of strategies to bring an atmosphere of nature to environments built by men. Several hospitals throughout the world have been using such strategies, such as Kotek Wat in Singapore and Ostra Psychiatry Hospital in Sweden. The choice of colors and materials for furniture, floor, and walls are changing from white or blue to materials that mimic wood or colors such as sandy brown or green. The need of semantic congruence of multisensory stimuli in hospitals' environments goes beyond the attempt to create an atmosphere of nature. As Ronald Melzack wrote, anticipation can influence how pain is perceived. A nature-inspired and cozier atmosphere in hospitals can help with that. In children's hospital, the atmosphere created, however, must go beyond coziness in order to help children deal with exams and treatments. Hospitals such as the UPMC Children's Hospital in Pittsburgh or Evelina Children's Hospital in London have changed their design in order to create a fun and happy atmosphere for children. But again, for many hospitals, such strategies are mainly related to visual stimuli. But it's not enough to create only a visually stimulating environment, especially in hospitals where smells and sounds are very characteristic and usually incongruent with fun or cozy visual stimuli. A multisensory perspective can help to create congruent atmospheres that can offer more engaging and immersive experiences for subjects. Studies about congruence of multisensory cues in architecture are not limited to hospital design. There is a lot of research regarding consumers' experience in stores and restaurants. For instance, studies show that playing French music in a wine store led to French wine outselling German wine, and playing German music led German wine to outsell French wine. Another interesting question to make from an architect's point of view is, could the congruent multisensory stimuli of a building facilitate consciousness of space? As already mentioned, studies have been showing that cross-modal congruent stimuli can facilitate stimulus detection. Could that work for our perception and the understanding of a building? If so, it is possible that wayfinding and even memorization of roads and spaces could be improved if architects and designers explored more congruent cross-modal cues in their designs. Perhaps complex buildings such as hospitals and schools could benefit of a better understanding of such matter. Another approach to such question regarding the importance of enriched multisensory atmospheres is to consider how the lack of stimuli or impoverished environments can also affect perception, consciousness, and well-being. Although there are sensory deprivation tanks being used as treatment to relax and to meditate, on the long term, sensory deprivation is known to cause severe anxiety, depression, and hallucinations. As we mentioned before, zoo animals kept in minimalist spaces presented neurotic and antisocial behavior that changed to normal patterns when the animals were put back in enriched environments. Could the combination of our homes and workplaces atmospheres lack enough multisensory congruent stimuli? If so, how could this affect not only behavior and perception, but also our mental and physical health on the long term? From Darwin to Donald Hebb and Marion Diamond, scientists have noticed that the brains of animals that lived in natural atmospheres were thicker and heavier than the brains of animals who lived caged, even if it was what they called an enriched cage. The architect Yohani Palasma says, every touching experience of architecture is multisensory. Qualities of space, matter, and scale are measured equally by the eye, ear, nose, skin, tongue, skeleton, and muscle. Architecture strengthens the existential experience, one's sense of being in the world, and this is essentially a strengthened experience of self. Instead of mere vision or the five classical senses, architecture involves several realms of sensory experience which interact and fuse into each other. Unfortunately, the communication in the architecture field is very visual. Sketches and pictures are a great way to present the general idea of a project. But as we discuss here, our experience of a space can be improved if architects and designers consider a more multisensory standpoint. Dialogues between cognitive science and architecture could lead to architects better comprehending how their design can impact subjects. This, in turn, could lead to architects incorporating such multisensory standpoint in their projects, creating more engaging, enriched, and memorable atmospheres for the spaces of our everyday life, where we will live, work, socialize, learn, and heal. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, feel free to contact me.
Hi everyone, I'm Cedric Kennard, and I will present today on the EG correlates of well-being and on a large sample, a recent study done, ready to be submitted soon. So first of all, what is well-being? This question has been asked forever in the human societies, but mainly there's two models, two views in philosophy of well-being, the hedonist view, where pleasure, happiness equals to pleasure, comfort, enjoyment, and the eudaimonic view, where happiness comes from having a life purpose, a sense of fulfillment, pursuing complex goals that are meaningful to individual and society. More recently, in psychology, well-being is defined as a more multidimensional and dynamic construct that englobes both views and other components such as autonomy, environmental mastery, personal growth, social relationships, and self-acceptance. In neuroscience, well-being, as well as other psychological constructs such as emotions, psychopathologies, mood, have been studied using the frontal alpha symmetry as a measure. So to simply explain what it is, you take the EEG activity from the left frontal area and the right frontal area, and then you select the alpha rhythm by computing its, the power spectrum. Here's what it looks like. And then you just do the difference in alpha power between the right side and the left side. There has been two main models over the past decades that have described the left frontal asymmetry as being what is associated with a positive effect and a motivational, an approach-oriented motivation, whereas the right frontal asymmetry is associated with a negative effect and a withdrawal-oriented motivation, like in depression, for example. But all these findings for decades were describing these associations, but didn't have any mechanisms for them. Only recently, the inhibition model has been proposed to explain what brain mechanisms are reflected by these asymmetries. And to summarize it, for example, with the right frontal asymmetry, there is a decreased activity in the left dorsal frontoparietal network, so of the other side of the asymmetry. And this network is coordinating the posterior parietal cortex that is involved in motricity, spatial cognition, attention, visual perception as well. And it is coordinating the DLPFC, which is highly involved in executive functions such as working memory, decision making, planification, inhibition, mental flexibility, etc. So this decrease in activity is reflected by a decrease in coordination in this system, and the asymmetry would reflect that. So in summary, a right asymmetry in this example corresponds to an inhibition of left executive control processes, which as a consequence triggers an inhibition of positive approach responses and an attentional bias towards negative information, like in depression, for example. The more you are depressed, the more you focus on negative information, perceive information as negative that someone else would perceive as positive, etc. And this is reflected by the asymmetry. This works as well for the other side, with the left asymmetry inhibiting the negative balance. And So this really helped understanding the mechanisms underlying the asymmetries. However, there's still some questions, like what is driving the asymmetry? For example, is the left asymmetry always associated with an increase in the left side or with a decrease in the right side or both? The neurophysiological studies show that it's generally a decrease on the other side in the DLPFC specifically. But this still needs to be clarified better. Also, are there asymmetries in the other frequency bands and other areas? Like, especially since alpha is an inhibition rhythm, and that's why they came up with the inhibition models. But with such a big network going from the frontal to parietal areas, I would expect to see other asymmetries potentially in other frequencies and other areas that could be impacted by this difference, these changes. Is there also a general EEG power activity associated with well-being independently from the asymmetries? Some studies have suggested that yes, like this one recently, that higher well-being is associated with a higher alpha and delta power, as well as a lower beta power. And lastly, what role do demographics play in these effects and interactions? A lot of studies have now recently suggested that demographics play a very important role in EEG activity and effects in EEG studies. For example, if you have a sample that's constituted by 95% females and 5% males, some studies suggested that the asymmetries were reflecting that gender dominance as opposed to an actual emotional state or psychological state. So One great way to respond to this question is to use big samples as they with a lot of diversity and demographics, and this will provide a better, bigger picture. So to respond to these questions, we collected data at the Institute of Noetic Science, where each year hundreds of groups visit to participate in transformational practices that focus on well-being, team cohesion, personal growth, transformation, meditation retreats, for example. We've built this lab to measure the groups, as many people as possible, before and after the interventions to assess how that affects them. And we measure well-being with this Arizona Integrative Outcome Scale that has been published by Bell in 2004 and colleagues, which is a visual scale that is very easy to do and provide accurate subjective reported well-being that reflects psychological, physical, emotional, and spiritual well-being over the past 24 hours. We also measure demographics, social interconnectedness, positive and negative effect, sense of purpose. So that's basically reflecting the other types of well-being or definition of well-being. Pain and sleep levels, general health that reflect more physical health, and interconnectedness with nature, among others. Then once people have completed the survey, we measure their EEG during a 2-minute breath counting exercise with eyes closed with the wearable EEG headset that has, which is called the Muse. It has 4 dry active electrodes, 2 frontal electrodes here, and the red arrows, and the rubber electrodes here behind the ears that measure brain activity on the temporal parietal areas. This device has been validated and used in ERP studies. For example, in this study showed that could accurate measure identify ERPs. The only difference is the lag due to Bluetooth, but that can be corrected, and it doesn't matter in this case as we're looking at continuous data. And so we found that by applying thorough methods of setup, like cleaning the skin with alcohol swipes and applying a thin layer of water on the electrodes, gets reliable signal quality. And the advantage of using this type of technology is that we can acquire large amounts of data compared to the more advanced systems that have maybe better quality, but that take a lot of time to set up, to inject the gel in the head cap holes and all the cables and cleaning of participants. We've developed some ECG electrodes that can connect to the Muse auxiliary port. I'll just skip this because we haven't analyzed the data yet. But basically, they can plug onto disposable electrodes, and we can just connect them to the wrist, which provides a comfortable, easy, and good quality ECG data that will allow us to do heart rate variability analysis. And the good advantage is that the data, ECG data, is time-locked with the EEG, so that's really convenient to do EEG-ECG interactions analysis and how that's associated with well-being. So I don't have time to talk about the pre-processings, but having 300 files recorded, we basically used and adapted and developed automatic methods to clean all the data. Once the data was clean, we computed the power spectrum on frequencies 1 to 50 hertz for exploratory analysis on those other frequencies, as well as and the same for the EEG asymmetries and temporal parietal areas. Then the data was analyzed using linear regression models. This is really a useful tool and measure to identify trends in populations that are not visible in small samples, as well as identifying covariables that may drive these effects, as I was saying earlier. The first analysis was done on well-being on the behavioral survey data, and was attempting to assess which factors with components were the most affecting or predicting the global subjective score. Affect was the most significant. Then it was interconnectedness with nature, which is interesting as it's not part of the main models of well-being, surprisingly. And purpose and interconnectedness with others, so it's more the eudaimonic view and in the social well-being components were not significant in this group. The overall model was significant and predicted 37% of variability in the global scores. So that suggests that we're missing some variables that are affecting this score. So the EEG results showed no significant frontal alpha asymmetry, which was surprising as it's the main effect in the literature, both as an outcome and as a predictor. However, there was a significant effect in the left temporoparietal area, so left asymmetry in that area, both as an outcome and as a predictor. This effect was not driven by demographics, and the EEG power analysis that were done, so on the same site, instead of doing the difference between the two to get the asymmetry, we just look at the EEG power on that site and that site and do linear regressions with well-being. And so that showed that the asymmetry was driven by the decrease in the left, in the right side. And interestingly, that there was a decrease on the left side as well, but a greater decrease on the right side. So that was what was driving the asymmetry. The next big analysis that was done using the NEMO plugin and a weighted least square regression, so it's more advanced type of regression, was done on all frequencies independently from 1 to 50, and on each electrode, it assesses if there are correlations between each electrode and each frequency, but taking into account the weight of each observation. And so this analysis showed a positive correlation in a beta frequency, more specifically 12 to 18 hertz, as you can see in the power spectrum, in the left frontal electrode, as you can see here as well, with a peak at 16 hertz. This result is robust, as this toolbox uses advanced statistical methods such as bootstrap techniques and robust corrections for multiple comparisons. And this effect was not driven by demographics either when inputting them in the model. So in summary, there were no frontal alpha asymmetry, so that was surprising. And my first guess to explain this is there may be a methodological bias with the sensor, with the muse that has its reference in FPZ here between the two frontal electrodes. That is probably significantly decreasing the differences between these two electrodes and could explain when there's no effect here. The trends seem to go in the direction of the asymmetry, but it's not significant. And these authors in this paper that describes the methods very thoroughly, different types of methods used in EEG asymmetry literature, showed how the choice of reference can really affect the effects, the activity that you observe. So there is no really alternative with this headset, as normally you could use a CZ electrode as a reference that's on the top of the head, but we don't have that here. And other methods like average reference or current source density methods need more electrodes to be done, at least 64 electrodes, I think. So can't do that here. I have combined the frontal and temporal electrodes of each side together to the asymmetry. And it was significant. This could be reflecting the whole frontoparietal network and could be interesting as a measure with this specific headset, as it covers both frontal and parietal electrodes areas. But on the long term, I will do another analysis. So I have 40 subjects that I recorded the data in the same condition with both the muse and the more advanced gel-based EEG biosimi system. So I will do some analysis to compare the signal and if it is really different because of the headset or not, and the asymmetries as well. The left temporal alpha asymmetry found significant was driven by a decrease in right side. This is interesting result and confirms the inhibition model and other findings that the asymmetry might be is probably driven by a decrease on the other side, not an increase on the side of the asymmetry. However, I haven't seen before that there could be a decrease in both sides, but a greater increase in one side that would be driving the asymmetry. So that's interesting, and future studies should try to elucidate that better. And exactly what is causing these decreases in alpha on the other side. The increased left frontal beta effect that was robust is novel finding and interesting. One could wonder if it's because of the breath counting task. I'm not familiar with that literature, but I will look into it if that could be reflecting the counting and focus on the breath. I know that meditation states that focus on breath are associated with the theta rhythm and mid-frontal areas. So I don't know anything about beta and meditation and this type of task, but there could be something there. Or it could be a robust marker of well-being, and future studies should investigate that more. So other future analysis that needs to be done, it will be interesting to do, or looking at the changes over time between before and after the intervention. All these results here were on a general population on each session before intervention. Also, other analysis will be done to look at the ECG activity, the heart rate variability, and the EEG-ECG interactions. That will probably show very interesting results as the heart activity is very involved in well-being, reflecting the parasympathetic system. Also, we're currently translating the survey in other languages, so that will allow us to get online data from other cultures and countries, and that will be very valuable information. That won't be beneficial for the EEG, obviously, but for the well-being part and factors involved with well-being will be really interesting. So to conclude, wearable EEG technologies are a very good tool. There's been a lot of improvements recently, a lot of innovations that helped really increase signal quality that was a problem before, as well as algorithm that can clean artifacts in real time. We published recently a book chapter on the current state, the applications, the limits, and future directions of these technologies. I invite you to read it if you're interested. They are really helping scientists better understand well-being and its correlates by allowing scientists to record large amounts of data and a more diverse population because of its comfort. This will help us, this better understanding will help us predict psychopathologies better and therefore develop new therapeutic tools and interventions sooner, such as neurofeedback training methods that are, have a lot of promise these days, brain stimulation methods where we can directly induce specific frequencies and increase frequencies in the brain in specific areas. And on the long-term genetic engineering, pharmacology, nanotechnology, and neurosurgery with intracranial electrodes that are being developed that will allow to record and stimulate the brain at more depth and accuracy without damaging the tissues when inserting them. This is especially relevant, all these findings and developments are really important, especially for psychopathologies such as addictions, depression, anxiety, or especially asymmetries seem to be a good candidate to treat those. So thank you very much for your attention. And I hope that my talk increased your left frontal asymmetry and positive effect and approach-oriented motivation. Thank you.